I'm Edmund Janiger, the founding president of the Rutgers Council on Public and International Affairs. I want to welcome you to the Rutgers CPIA, a student-run, nonpartisan organization sponsored by the School of Public Affairs and Administration. This afternoon, for the World Leaders Forum, which is dedicated to providing dynamic, unrestrained dialogue on the large social, political, and economic issues of our times. As part of the World Leaders Forum, we look forward to hosting statesmen and diplomats from around the world and from all sides of the political spectrum. Founded before the American Revolution, Rutgers, one of the nation's leading public research universities, has been revolutionary for 250 years. Today, we continue that tradition. Our speaker is a legendary Polish statesman and former anti-communist dissident. The Rutgers Council on Public and International Affairs is honored to welcome Antoni Macierewicz. Let me now introduce our learned dean, Dr. Mark Holzer, the chairman of the Council's Board of Advisors. Dr. Holzer is the founding dean of the Rutgers University Newark School of Public Affairs and Administration, Board of Governors, Distinguished Professor of Public Affairs and Administration, and has served as the 49th president of the American Society of Public Administration.
Oh, and let me introduce our chancellor, Nancy Kanter. Chancellor has been very supportive of these efforts, and we very much look to connecting with the Polish community as well as many of the other communities in northern New Jersey and environs. So this is really an extension of our role as an anchor institution in the area. So Nancy, you could sit down if you'd like. This is chill. But whatever. Okay. But thank you, Nancy. So. First, I want to congratulate the Polish community on the Academy Award, the Oscar for the best foreign language film, the other night. I don't know if you were all aware, but it was a significant achievement, I think, for Polish filmmakers. So. Edmund mentioned the American Revolution and that Rutgers was founded, before the revolution. I just wanted to underscore the fact that we share a commitment to freedom with Poland. It's very deep, and that Polish generals were very important to the American Revolution. Particularly in New Jersey, Pulaski, from the roadway, is named after a Polish general who actually saved George Washington's life at one point. That was a turning, would have been a turning point in our history, and that other Polish figures were very, very important. Kosciuszko, I think, in terms of my pronunciations might not be quite right, but in terms of other elements of the American Revolution and building West Point, and I think that what has happened in the 20th century really indicated that the U.S. and Poland share that commitment, to freedom and democracy in many ways, and we still do now in the 21st century. So, where there's an identity of interest here that extends to many of our other communities, but this has been a model of a partnership and alliance over many centuries, and freedom in Poland. The sense of freedom really dates back hundreds and hundreds of years, because Poland was one of the few European countries that actually welcomed Jewish immigrants for hundreds of years, for at least 500 years, for which we're very grateful. I know that I'm grateful, and my family was grateful, and they have roots in Poland. So I very much look forward to the minister's talk today, and I think this will open up a new dimension of an international dialogue. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Holzer. Minister Macierewicz was born in Warsaw. It's a patriotic Polish family, with history dating to the Polish-Russian War of 1792. His father, a chemistry professor, who took part in World War II as a Home Army soldier, was killed by the security office in 1949. Minister Mitrevich began his democratic activism while still in high school, leading his expulsion. Minister Mitrevich studied at the Faculty of History of the University of Warsaw, earning a master's degree. As a doctoral student at the Institute of History of the Polish Academy of Sciences, he specialized in the history of South America. Minister Mitrevich's efforts were crucial in Poland's victory over its communist regime during the 80s. He co-founded the forerunner of Solidarity, the Workers' Defense Committee, commonly known as CORE. He edited The Voice, a leading underground publication. He led the Solidarity Research for Social Self-Defense. Social Research. And he was held as a political prisoner before escaping. Minister Mitrevich is today one of Poland's most prominent politicians. He served as Minister of Internal Affairs in the Olszewski government and head of the Military Counterintelligence Service in the Kaczynski government. He's currently deputy leader of Law and Justice, one of the two major contemporary political parties in Poland. In 1992, Minister Mitrevich published the so-called Mitrevich List, which vetted public officials who collaborated with the communist regime. In 2006, he was president of the Verification Commission and authored the highly publicized Mitrevich Report, a document that investigated the communist era as well as present-day special forces in Poland. He then liquidated the communist era military information services and established new ones. First elected in 1991 to the Sejm, the lower house of Poland's parliament, he has been re-elected four times. In the current term, he leads the parliamentary group investigating the plane crash that killed Poland's president, first lady, and 94 other dignitaries in Smolensk, Russia, as they were heading to commemorations of the Katyn massacre. Minister Mitrevich, we're honored you've joined us today to speak to us about peace and security in Central Europe. Once again, welcome to the Rutgers Council of Public International Affairs. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Chancellor Nancy Kantor, Mark Holzer, Dean, I special want to thank you for the invitation. It was a grand honor for me to be here. And especially I want to thanks to Mr. Edmund Jenger, who I met 2 years ago during the anniversary of Warsaw Uprising. And we talked about the situation in Poland and in Central Europe. And he said to me, if you want that every world will listen to you, you have to be at the Rutgers University because here are the most influential students and scientists. And here I am. And now please let me tell and start my... Excuse me. Okay, this is my presentation. Okay, just 1 moment, yes. I would like to start my presentation with quite a lengthy but enlightening quotation from an interview with Alexander Dugin, the main Kremlin ideologue, who said, so, we Russians and Germans, we reason in terms of expansion and we will never reason otherwise. You are not interested in simple reservation of our state or nation. You are interested in absorbing the greatest number of complementary categories. In this geopolitical and sacred geographical development, Russia is not interested in the existence of independent Polish state in any form, neither is Russia interested in the existence of Ukraine? Not because we don't like Poles or Ukrainians, but because such are laws of sacred geography and geopolitics. Is it possible that any nation, country, or politician talks in such a way about another country? Is it possible that in our times there exist people who want to eliminate other countries or nations? Up till now we have heard such words from Iranian Ayatollah talking about Israel. Now we hear it from a Russian politician and philosopher talking about Poland and other states of Central Europe. Alexander Dugin, one of the most influential Russian political thinkers and advisor to Mr. Putin, writes in his book, "The countries between Russia and Germany should disappear. There is no place for such small nations. Now it is a time for empires." And Dugin is not alone. The same or very similar ideas are expressed by Andrew Piontkowski, Michael Inozemtsov, Paul Goebel, and others. What does it mean from geopolitical point of view? Let's have a look. Let's have a look at the map. Excuse me, once more. Thank you.
You can click right here.
Here?
Right there.
Okay.
And then say okay. And then
okay.
We can.
And now.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Let's have a look at the map of Europe. Dugin's, and we can now say Putin's, geopolitical philosophy means that they want to eliminate or subjugate 300 million of people and such territory of one third of Europe and such an economic potential. For many people, security depends and results from peace, which in fact is not true. It is exactly opposite. Peace is the consequence of security. It is not a new idea. As you know, in the ancient Roman Empire, there was a saying, civis pacem, para bellum. If you want peace, prepare for war. The same is valid today. If you want to live in peace, first of all, you have to think of security. And I mean here all types of security, economic, social, political, and geopolitical. But in the first place, there comes, of course, military security. Our situation, I mean now about the Poland, our situation from a formal point of view is not bad. Central European countries are members of NATO, and this alliance is the greatest and strongest organization in the world, and even stronger than Russia. You can see, one moment. Okay. There are figures and numbers which show it. The NATO alliance is stronger in every military problem, have the greatest budget, have the more jets, more tanks, more soldiers, and even more the missiles with atomic bombs ready to strike. But let me concentrate on the geopolitical problems, and we will see another aspect of our situation. For 100 years, Poland has existed or not between Russia and Germany in their different political shapes. All this time, both neighboring countries have been wanting and trying to dominate not only Poland, but also other countries and nations which have been unfortunate to find themselves between the two voracious neighbors. such geopolitical situation is our fate, and we cannot change it. What we can do is to use it to our advantage and to make it work on behalf of our country and its people. Let me explain it. If Russia and Germany tend to dominate all the countries which separate them, it means that Poland has many potential allies which face the same threat and therefore share similar goals. Here in the first place I would like to mention countries such as Ukraine, Slovakia. Ukraine, Slovakia, Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia, Romania, and even Georgia. To these countries, which were all occupied in different way by the Soviet Russia, we have added Scandinavian countries, Scandinavian states in the north, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, as well as Turkey in the south, which constantly remains under pressure from the Russian side. Now let's have a look at the map of the region, which is here. And you will realize that if united, Central Europe could become a really significant power. The region has a population of more than 300 million and access to energy sources in Azerbaijan and other Central Asia states, as well as, from a geopolitical point of view, a key position in Europe between Russia and Germany. What does it mean that such a union would have a key position? It means that the new political organization could separate Russia and Germany forever and thus annihilate the dream of Euro-Asian empire. Someone could say here, threat to Central Europe, and Europe from either Russia or Germany does not exist. These are fears which have no solid ground, as Germany is a part of European Union and Russia is a peaceful country, of course, especially we see it today. None of them would want to create an empire from Lisbon to Vladivostok, and none of them want to dominate Poland, Ukraine and other states in Central Europe. This is a very interesting way of thinking, but of course it's not true. But because we have recently heard on Russian TV and from Russian politicians, Russia can occupy whole Poland in 3 days. And we see the Russian army and Russian specialists from cover operation in Donetsk, and we can expect that this army will go to other countries and other states of East Europe. 5 years ago, nobody wanted to think about the real situation. Polish politicians from independent parties, such as Law and Justice, were treated like madmen, and they were even called so. The world politics was dominated by the reset in relation with Russia and by a dream of an American-Russian alliance. Such way of thinking was very popular not only 5 years ago, but even 1 year ago among Polish ruling elite. At this time, Minister of Foreign Policy of Poland used to say that Russia was a country which was modernizing and itself and was on the way to democracy. He said also that Berlin should take over the leadership of Europe. These people wanted to become intermediary between Russia and Germany, because such was the position of Angela Merkel, who also thought that Russia was changing. And she believed it because she dreamt about creating a great economic and political union in which the Russian surplus of natural resources, especially of gas and oil, will complement the technological potential of Germany and European Union. In such a plan, Poland was in fact not intermediary, but an obstacle which should be eliminated if it does not agree to collaborate with Germany and Russia on their condition, of course. And it was openly expressed in a speech of Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin, Russian Prime Minister at the time, in Poland on the 1st of September 2009, on the occasion of the anniversary of the beginning of the Second World War. The day before, Mr. Putin, in his interview for the largest Polish newspaper, said that the construction of Europe based on the European Union should be changed through an agreement between Russia and Germany. Poland, said Mr. Putin, can join the agreement. President of Poland, Lech Kaczyński, in his speech at the same 1st of September occasion, rejected Putin's proposal. Prime Minister, Mr. Tusk, accepted it. One might believe it or not, but these are the facts everyone in Poland heard and saw. You can read articles, speeches, and interviews. Now it can be added that Mr. Kaczyński is dead, and Mr. Tusk is the chairman of the European Union. It means that the policy of uniting the countries between Germany and Russia is possible, but it is also very difficult and even dangerous. We are talking now about the events which took place 5 or even 6 years ago. At that time, few politicians wanted to think about Ukraine and the fate of Central Europe. But Mr. Kaczyński did, and he knew that the politicians in Germany and especially in Russia were thinking about it too. This is why he wanted to help Georgia when this country was attacked by Russia in 2008, and wanted Georgia and Ukraine to join NATO. He worked towards these aims because he knew that Russia had already started to rebuild its empire, and if the free world approves the aggression against Georgia, the next step of Russia will be the partition of Ukraine, the Baltic states, and even Poland. He said it during the huge manifestation in Tbilisi while the Russian army was invading Georgia. But Russia and Germany opposed Georgia and Ukraine joining NATO, and USA was hesitating. With Mr. Kaczyński talking and this manifestation in Tbilisi during the invasion of Russian army. Such approach of the Western world to Russia proved to be wrong. Its results could be seen on the 10th of the April 2010, when the plane with the Polish president, Lech Kaczyński, on board, crashed at the Smolensk aerodrome. At that moment, I was at Katyn, at the Katyn Memorial, some 20 kilometers away from Smolensk, where, with the 100 combatants of the Second World War and Polish Army soldiers, we were waiting for President Kaczynski. He was supposed to arrive to Katyn for the memorial service of the 70th anniversary of genocide of Polish officers by Bolsheviks in 1940. At that time, following the Stalin's order, 23,000 high-ranking officers, policemen, professors, and other members of Polish elite had been killed by KGB, it's been the civil services, and GRU, it means the military clandestine services, special services, with a shot in the back of their heads. They were the prisoners of war which Soviet Army had taken during the first weeks of the Second World War, when Poland was divided between Germany and Bolshevik Russia, then a Hitler's ally. Germany took the West and Russia occupied the east of our country. Both powers wanted then to eliminate the Polish state and the Polish nation. These were the consequences of this partition, that the graves of Polish soldiers on the left in 1940, and on the right, you see this cemetery today. The memorial service of the 70th anniversary did not take place. The plane with President Kaczynski and a great part of Polish elite on board crashed near the runway of Smolensk Aerodrome. On board, there were 96 persons, including Mr. President and the First Lady, all the highest commanders of Polish armed forces. That is the Chief of General Staff, the commanders of the land forces, special forces, air forces, and sea forces, ministers, senators, members of parliament, the Chief of the National Bank of Poland, and even Anna Walentynowicz, the heroine of the Solidarity Movement, who had received the American Medal of Freedom from the hands of President George W. Bush. All the passengers and the crew died in the crash. Nobody survived. With the view of the crash 15 minutes later. Russian officials from the beginning blamed the Polish pilots. They said that it had been the pilots' fault as they didn't know Russian and tried to land in bad weather conditions without approval of the air control. All these Russian explanations were false. But in the first moment after the crash, the Russians admitted that the plane had been distracted by an explosion and that it had started to burn. Even Mr. Putin said it to Mr. Tusk during their conversation in the evening of the 10th of April. The words of Mr. Putin were especially interesting, as he said that the plane had changed the course and it would have hit a nearby factory if it didn't fall earlier. Yielding to pressure from the Russian side, the Polish government accepted that investigation would be conducted on the basis of Chicago Convention, which applies to civil plane crashes only. But the Polish Tupolev was a military plane. It belonged to the Polish Air Forces and to the Polish state. Also, the site of crash, the Smolensk aerodrome, is a military facility. It has to be reminded here that in 1993, Poland and Russia signed an agreement regulating such cases of military air crashes. The thing is that this bilateral agreement required that a common investigative Polish-Russian commission should be established. The Russian side did not want to follow the agreement and its provisions, and insisted on choosing, incorrectly, the Chicago Convention because it allowed them to conduct an investigation on their own, without Poland's participation. Also, according to the Convention, all the decisions concerning the inquiry were transferred to the country where the crash occurred. Thus, Poland was de facto excluded from the investigation and has never received the greater part of the Russian documentation concerning, for example, the procedures valid on the aerodrome, has never been able to investigate the original black boxes and other key documents and evidence. Up to date, Poland has not been returned these documents, the boxes, and the wreck of the plane. It was 5 years ago, and up to now we have not our property and the evidences without which the investigation is practically impossible. The application of the Chicago Convention gave the Russian side full freedom to do with evidence whatever they wanted, and they wanted it either destroyed or falsified. Even the autopsy documentation was falsified by the Russian side, and the bodies themselves, sent back to Poland in sealed coffins, had been swept. The family of Mrs. Valentinovich still does not know where the body of their mother and grandmother is buried, because the body which was supposed to be hers is not. Is Mrs. Valentinovich the last photo of her during her 80th anniversary in the palace of President Kaczynski. What really happens is that the plane was destroyed by two huge explosions. The second one was decisive, as it cut all electrical power on board, and what follows, all the plane devices stopped working. It took place 1 second before the plane hit the ground, at the height of 15 meters above it. We know all these details from the examination of flying manager system at terrain awareness system devices, which were investigated by the American National Transportation Safety Board, and were unique devices which had not been tampered with by the Russians. This is why we can trust their recordings. The plane didn't reach the runway. It fell 300 meters from it and 100 meters to the left of the glide pass. The explosion was so strong that the Polish archaeologists, who half a year later worked on the site of the crash, assessed that there were 60,000 pieces of the plane, most of them not bigger than a child's hand. This, you can look at it, of the one satellite photograph, which was reconstructed by Professor Nowaczyk, which here is it. For comparison of the Boeing airplane, which of the Boeing airplane, which exploded over the Lockerbie in England, fell apart 30,000 pieces. And here was 60,000 of pieces of the airplane. But the conclusion that such total destruction of the plane had to be a result of an explosion did not come from the Russian investigation, but from the research done by the Polish archaeologists and from its findings, which of course they had to leave to the Russian officials responsible for the investigation. Up till now, none of the archaeological collection has been sent to Poland. The Russians have not even tried to reconstruct the plane from the wreck, which is a regular procedure in such situation. The remains of the plane which we can see on the aerodrome constitute probably only half of the wreck. The Russians have never tried to find the parts of plane which were destructed by explosion or fire, because at the beginning of the investigation they had assumed that there was neither explosion nor fire. They even changed the position of some parts of the plane which fell down too far away to fit their version of the crash. This was the case of the left stabilizer, which fell off first more than 150 meters away from the rest of the large bits of the plane, for example, the fuselage. The number of pieces, the scattering, the necessity to move the plane bits to cover up the real cause of the crash, all this shows that the plane was destroyed in the air by an explosion. This is a comparison of the first place of the left stabilizer. You can see it on the left, and the second, when the Russian changed the position of the stabilizer in the center of the photograph. I have presented here, on one hand, only several out of numerous evidence of the actual cause of the crash, and on the other hand, of the Russian falsification, tampering with, or destruction of evidence throughout the investigation. All this knowledge is the result of the parliamentary investigation which has been taking place since 2010, and which was possible thanks to cooperation of many scientists and experts of aviation investigation from many countries, USA, Canada, Germany, Russia. We have the two experts from Russia, Australia, and of course from Poland. Thanks to their work, we know now that the crash of the Polish Tupolev, Polish plane, was not a result of an accident, but of sabotage. And we have confirmed what we have suspected from the beginning, the death of the Polish elite, with the president on board, was the first shot in a new war. But this knowledge has come too late. In the meantime, Mr. Putin was able to invade Ukraine and to shot down the Malaysian Boeing with 385 passengers on board. If NATO, European Union, and other international organizations had properly investigated the Smolensk tragedy, maybe the citizens of Netherlands would have been still alive. Ukraine would have not been attacked, and the Russian army would have not have been so close to the Polish and NATO borders. Thank you. Now, if it's possible, I want to show you some parts of the simulation, movie simulation of its tragedy that explain what was the really cause of this crash. No, second one, yes, here, yes, because this was
April 10th, 2010. A date that no Pole should let pass unnoticed. 7:27 a.m. A government aircraft, Tu-154M, with President Lech Kaczynski on board, takes off from Warsaw Chopin Airport and heads towards Smolensk North Airport, Severna, in Russia. On the surface, everything seemed to be running smoothly. Nobody expected that this day would live in infamy in our country's history. Perhaps events would have taken a different course had the government not organized separate visits for Prime Minister Tusk and President Kaczynski. The tragedy certainly would not have occurred if Interpol's warning of the threat of a terrorist attack had been taken seriously. However, we were less than an hour away from the greatest aviation disaster to befall the Polish Air Force in its history, and the greatest tragedy in the history of independent Poland. How is it possible that, 4 years after the tragic flight, fundamental questions remain unanswered? Why is the main evidence regarding the wreckage, the so-called black boxes and navigation instruments, are still not in the hands of Polish authorities? Why is it not possible to conclude the investigation and to give a clear explanation of the causes of the disaster? Why did the Prosecutor General not scrutinize and examine the wreckage in its entirety, ignoring sections that were burned and blown apart by an explosion? Why didn't the Prosecutor General scrutinize the original black boxes, or did not carry out autopsies or create a reconstruction of the wreckage? Indeed, why is the Prosecutor General still refusing to investigate the most likely cause of the disaster, an explosion in the final stage of the flight? Do we not, as a nation, deserve to find out the truth? The parliamentary group established to investigate the causes of the Tu-154M disaster of 10th of April 2010 has created a visualization of the most likely scenario for the final seconds of the government aircraft's flight. What we find today in the location where the Russians have gathered parts of the aircraft wreckage, they are in fact only incomplete remnants which have been destroyed, premeditatedly and on many occasions, under any possible pretext. Significant parts are missing from the fuselage covering, especially from the upper section, the president's cabin and the cockpit, which were ripped apart and crushed, as well as the left and right wings and the midsection. What happened to the missing parts? Archaeologists identified some of them 3 months after the disaster. Independent scientists are in no doubt that the only possible cause of such severe damage was a number of explosions. They ripped apart the aircraft, which fell apart into over 60,000 fragments. Lieutenant Rafał Kowaleczko, crew member of the Yak-40 aircraft. I'm in shock the whole time and I can't get over it. People have to find out what it was like there. Even now, all I hear is that all the blame lies with the Polish pilots. But here at the airport, there were some weird things going on with the handling of the flight that need to be explained. We now know that guidance of the Polish government aircraft was taken over by the Moscow Air Traffic Control Operations Center, codenamed Logika, which was commanded by General Vladimir Benediktov. It was his orders that were being followed by Major Krasnokutsky, who unexpectedly appeared in the control tower in Smolensk and took over command. It was he who ordered the aircraft to be brought in to land, even though air traffic controllers felt that it should be sent to an alternative airport. Air traffic controllers from Smolensk Pavel Plusnin and Viktor Rezenko asked Moscow at several points to indicate alternative airports and to close Smolensk North Airport. However, Moscow refused, and Krasnokutsky ordered the aircraft to be brought in to land without discussion. Meanwhile, the Polish crew had no intention to land. Given the prevailing weather conditions, Major Protasiuk issued an order to the crew 9 minutes before the disaster to prepare and get ready for a go-around maneuver, abort landing, and circle the airport around. In the event of a missed approach, we leave on autopilot. Given the prevailing conditions, the entire procedure should have been carried out with more prior notice from the Russian control tower. Additionally, when the Tu-154M was at a distance of 9 kilometers from the airport, the crew was erroneously informed by air traffic controllers that the aircraft was on track. The aircraft should be guided by the controller along a descent path of 2 degrees 40 minutes. The actual descent path was 3 degrees 12 minutes. Due to the air traffic controller's errors, the pilots did not have sufficient time to stabilize their navigation instruments. At no point were they on path and on course. The aircraft's landing point was almost 1 kilometer closer than the actual beginning of the runway. With 2 minutes to go before the disaster, a series of misleading pieces of information were given to the crew. The tower stated 8 on path and on course. In reality, however, the Tu-154M was 130 meters above the path and had strayed from the course by 80 meters. The subsequent information was also misleading. Continue your approach, on path and on course, distance 6. At that moment, the aircraft was 120 meters above the path and 120 meters to the side of the center line of the runway. The crew of the Polish Yak-40 aircraft mentioned finding the aircraft to the left of the runway. Ensign Remigiusz Musz, technician on the Yak-40 aircraft. We decided to head to the scene of the crash. It became apparent that the site was not 1,500 meters away, as we had previously been informed, but 400 to 500 meters from the start of the runway and 50 meters to the left of the direction of landing. Now just over 20 seconds remain until the catastrophe. The pilots decided at an altitude of 100 meters to go around, stop descent and circle the airport. However, their instruments were not following their commands and the aircraft continued to descend. The commander of the Polish aircraft gave out the order, "Go around." This command was repeated 1 second later by the second pilot. Despite this, the aircraft continued to descend. The plane navigator read out the distance of the approach ground and the TAWS alarm started to sound. Pull up. After reaching 30 meters above runway level, the pilot manually pulled up the machine. The aircraft then reached 20 meters before finally starting to pull up as part of a going around and abort of landing procedure. When the Tu-154M passed the nearest radio beacon, a series of shocks occurred that were caused by an explosion on the wing. The aircraft started to veer dangerously to the left. The following shocks destabilized the aircraft, and the damaged engine started to cut out and interrupt, causing the aircraft to rapidly lose altitude. As a result of the damage, the aircraft veered more pronouncedly, while the remains of the ring and the stabilizer crashed into trees, as well as onto roofs of garages and huts, causing further damage. This is how that moment was described by the air traffic controllers, who had, at that very moment, lost the Polish Tu-154M from sight. "Where is it?" asked Krasnokutsky. "It just flew past the nearby radio beacon. It will be on the left, somewhere beside the road. It started to pull up to make another approach and then fell." Anatoly Zuyev, witness. "We were standing on the edge of the garage. We could not see anything. No aeroplane, nothing. The sound of the aeroplane was rather flat, beautiful and soft. I went off to take a look, but I could not see it. Suddenly the motors roared as much as they could and the aeroplane held together as best it could. It flew on like that for a moment, passing us in a flash. Then there was an explosion, yellow, like the yolk of an egg. It was round, and that was it." Sergei Vandarov, witness, owner of a detached house. This day will remain in my memory until the end of my days. I saw the disaster with my own eyes. It occurred right in front of my house. I live barely 400 meters from the site of the disaster. That Saturday morning, I was in front of the house when I suddenly heard a terrible rumbling sound. An aircraft appeared in the foggy sky. An aircraft like any other, I thought. Given that I live just a few hundred meters from the airport, I've been able to get used to such a sight. However, there was one thing that stunned me. At a certain moment, the roar simply disappeared. Literally, for a split second, there was an eerie silence above the forest. I turned my head and saw a falling aeroplane. My legs gave way beneath me. A moment later, there was an awful roar, and the glow of a fire appeared among the trees. I cannot believe what happened. I particularly cannot believe that the tragedy took place before my very eyes and right in front of my house. The TU-154M was passing the Gubenko Highway. It was here that the end of the left wing fell off after being damaged during the explosion. It was found less than 20 meters away on the ground. A hail of fragments struck nearby trees, fences, and hut roofs. Fragments also struck the stabilizer. The aeroplane's left engine was also damaged. Igor Fomin, witness, mechanic. The aeroplane was making a strange noise as it flew, a loud whistling, crackling sound. It sounded like gunfire. Then there was a thud, and flame shot out. The pilots lost control of the aeroplane, which violently changed course. 150 meters from the highway, at an altitude of 16 meters from the airport's runway, there was an explosion in the rear section of the fuselage, which caused it to detach from the aeroplane. The explosion also ripped off the aeroplane's tail and caused the stabilizer to break off. Nikolai Shevchenko, witness, local bus driver. It was at a height of 12 to 13 meters when it started to turn due to the absence of the wing. It struck a tree, which caused it to straighten out. It flew over the road and then something fell off it, a part of the tail. It then struck the ground just beyond the road. Marif Ipatov. Witness, I saw the aeroplane flying away. It was going so low and it fell apart, it lurched. I noticed that something serious was happening. It was creaking, creaking. Then there was a noise like a bomb. Lieutenant Rafał Kowalechko, crew member of the Yak-40 aircraft. Once we had landed, some of us stood by the airport's runway and waited for the TU-154M. The pilots returned to the aeroplane and communicated with the crew of the presidential aircraft over the radio. They learned from us that there was fog and that the conditions were bad. However, they did not panic. Less than 20 minutes later, we heard the sound of the TU-154M approaching the airport. Initially, the sound was completely normal and the engine was running normally. At a certain moment, though, there was a bang from the engine similar to the sound made when the engine starts up. We knew immediately that something was wrong. A moment later, we heard the sound of two explosions, followed by some thuds. Then everything went silent. We were terrified, as we knew that a disaster had occurred. Once the rear section of the fuselage had exploded and the tail had been ripped off, another explosion occurred that completely destroyed the aeroplane. The center section of the wing and the fuselage were destroyed and fell in an inverted position. The fuselage lining was totally ripped apart, in particular the president's cabin and the cockpit, most of which was never found. The parts that were saved struck the ground in a normal position. Ensign Remigio Shmush, technician on the Yak-40 aircraft. We left the aeroplane to look for the Tupolev. The weather and the visibility deteriorated further. I returned to the aeroplane and broadcasted, "Arek, visibility is at 200 over the radio." He responded by saying, "Thanks." I then returned before the aeroplane. Several minutes later, we heard the characteristic whistling sound of the Tupolev engines, typical due to the reduced number of revolutions associated with descent. Suddenly, the revolutions increased to the maximum. 2 seconds later, there was some blow and three explosions, and then there was a brief sound of one of the engines stalling. Then there was silence. The other torn-off fragments were found about 30 meters apart from each other. These fragments were a section of the starboard of the presidential cabin and toilet with windows, the starboard with some of the writing Republic of Poland, blind doors, the president's sofa. 30 meters from the board in the fourth sector, the body of the President of the Republic of Poland, Lech Kaczynski, was found. Clear signs of an explosion were noted in the form of incineration, tearing, carbonization, and sooting, all of which testified to the effects of fire underneath and on the surface of the inverted center section of the wing and the right wing, and above all, on the internal surface of the wall of the president's cabin. As the Russian experts later ascertained, both wings had been ripped apart by a pressure wave from inside, which resulted in the frame being ripped apart and destroyed, and in the upper wing casing being blown outwards. This fact was ignored by the Polish prosecutor's office, the Anadina report, Russian, and the Miller report, Polish. Lieutenant Artur Wosztyl, pilot of the Yak-40 aircraft. As we were standing by our plane, we heard the sound of the Tu-154's engines as it approached to land. I recognized it from the characteristic sound of its engines. I should point out that I did not see it. I only heard it. It was the sound of an approach to land at a fixed engine output level. At one point, I heard the engine go into the range associated with ignition. It was as if the pilot wanted to increase the revolutions in order to straighten out the plane or to pull up. At that point, I wondered what could have caused them to take such a step and decision. A few seconds after the revolutions were increased, I heard loud bangs, roars, and detonations. Then there was the sound of the engine fading out before everything went quiet. I found these sounds terrifying, and I hope that I will never hear them again in my life. The passengers of the Tupolev had no chance, and to this day we do not know the circumstances of their deaths. In any case, the time entered in all of the death certificates was 8:10:50, i.e. 9 minutes after the plane crashed into the ground. All of the deaths were attributed to injuries to multiple organs, regardless of whether the cause of death was being torn apart, as occurred in the rear section of the plane, being burnt to death, as occurred in the central section of the plane, or as yet unknown causes of the head injuries sustained by one Government Protection Bureau agent in the front of the aircraft. The body of President Lech Kaczynski was found roughly 4 hours after the rescue mission was called off. Of the 96 victims, 89 were not subjected to post-mortem examinations.
Нихуя себе! Нихуя себе!
Okay, thank you. That's all. Now, if you have some question, ask. Okay.
See if there are any questions.
Sure.
Please, if you have any questions, you can ask the questions now.
In April of 2010, I wrote an article in Novinjenik, which basically talked about American experiences with Soviets shooting down their transportation planes. And basically, I was talking about a book which was declassified. So they were mainly talking about their experiences in the 1950s and 60s, but from what I understood, it also happened later. And basically, what happened, the Russians used the deceptive radio beacons on their borders. They lured American planes. It was proven that was done on the Turkish border and also on the Norwegian border, but they suspect that happened on all the borders. And the moment American the transportation plane that was going to Iran or somewhere crossed the border by accident, it was shot down by the Soviet Air Force. And I sort of was drawing the parallel, you know, that maybe this is what happened here, but of course I had no idea whether it was true, but it looked like this was an explosion from the beginning to me. So I wanted to ask you, is there any parallel? It looked like there were elements of deceptive radio beacons, there were explosions, and did it come from internal explosion, were the bombs on the plane, or was it through a rocket that was shot from the outside?
Thank you for it. We we've thought about such possibility, and after all, I want to say that in this situation of TU-154 with Mr. President on the board, there were two phases, two situations. The first, which is similar to this what you said, the deception of the probably yes
radio beacons
and others deception to make that the plane will be very close to the ground, because the destruction of the planes, if it is very close to the ground, looks like an accident, or may look like the accident. And the second part was the destruction by the bomb or missiles. We think there are two hypotheses in this case. One of our experts, they are saying that it was the missiles, and other that that after all the bomb inside the fuselage, and this is a discussion which is not ended now.
Yes.
Okay. Please.
Why doesn't the Polish government, in view of this compelling evidence that your parliamentary commission has presented, why doesn't the Polish government take action and call for an independent international investigation of the Smolensk disaster?
It's hard to say. I don't really know. But we have to remember that it was 5 years ago. It was time of rest game. And I think that it influenced or at the attitude of government of Mr. Tusk, but I really didn't know.
Please. We know that you it's not your first trip, and you have talks among American politicians. You present this case to American politicians. Can you update us if there's any interest, if there's any lack of America looking into this, or maybe releasing some of the information they might have from their satellites, which would help your, you know, your group to investigate it any further?
The attitude of USA politicians is changing during these years. Now it's more open than 5 years ago, of course. Excuse me, what journal?
The Wall Street Journal.
Wall Street Journal, okay.
Wrote an article about President Putin. And the piece of the article was that President Putin doesn't have a plan. All of the decisions what he makes are strictly reaction to the current events based on the emotion. Do you agree with that?
No, that's really new idea, and maybe it was the letter of some which never knew the Russian politicians and Russian history. It's not possible.
In one of your slides, you made reference to Obama's nightmare. Can you explain that?
Actually, I didn't understand. Yes, but there were the fears of Obama. No, I think it's a mistake. Maybe I said something wrong. Excuse me. I didn't think that the Obama have such fears. We have such fears about the union between the Germany and Russia. And if Mr. President have started, maybe, I didn't know nothing about it.
Let's take one more, please. Okay, one more question.
Okay.
Would you dilate on your point, expand on your point, on why it's a danger for American security, for United States security, to have Germany and Russia taking over the
intermarium? I thought that it's clearly when we see the map of the Earth, especially the map of the Euro-Asian plan. Because, you know, with this agreement between Germany and Russia, practically all this huge continent from Lisbon to Vladivostok is lost for the free world. And the consequences for the United States are obvious. There will the practically the initiative of the fall of United States if the situation will come to this point.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes.
After the crash, Congressman Peter King introduced a resolution in U.S. Congress about independent investigation of the crash. And there was one other resolution that was introduced, but they sort of died of natural death. So I wanted to ask you, is there movement in Congress to introduce a new resolution that will be backed up by more political action?
Yes, I heard that the Polish-American Congress, which represents the most or very big number of Polish descendants, people living here in the United States, sent the letter to Mr. Menendez, which is chairman of Senate Commission of Foreign Affairs, to initiate the public hearings about this tragedy, about this sabotage, about the crash. And it's signed, they said me, by the Mr. Spula, which is chairman of Polish-American Congress, if I'm not mistaken. I think that it's true, yes? Okay. And maybe it will be initiate of new situation, new political situation, and new information about what really happened with Polish president and the elite of the Polish state. Because the most important problem, you know, is that never in the history of mankind was such tragedy that in one moment, 1 second, was distracted all the elite of the big country and big nations and the member of NATO, of course, too. I don't remember, I don't think that anyone remembers such situation in our history of the past 300 years. It was not never heard. And especially if we see what happened after it, this 5 years from this moment is the years of initiating the war on the NATO and on the free countries by the Russia. It was the first moment, first shot in this war.
Mr. Minister, thank you for coming. Thank you for enlightening us.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you a lot.